the King of Kings. Good morning and good Resurrection Sunday morning. Amen. This is a special day, a day that we come together in our hearts and our minds and our prayers and our spirit to recognize, to honor the resurrection of our Lord. If it were not for the resurrection, there would be no faith. Without the resurrection, there would be no church. Without the resurrection, there would be no eternal life through Jesus Christ. We know that on this Resurrection Sunday morning, we are in the midst of a terrible, terrible pandemic. It is a terrible time. This past week has seen the incredible loss of life in various places throughout our nation, especially in the area of the northeast of New Jersey in New York City. And we certainly want to be in prayer for those families who have lost their precious loved ones. We feel helpless in times like these to do much of anything about what's going on. But I'm reminded that the Bible teaches us that the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So we can make a difference because we can call on heaven and God will hear our prayer. Amen. So be in prayer for those who are grieving during this terrible time of loss, that God would hold them and keep them in their time of bereavement. There is a word from the Lord, and we find this word this morning in the gospel according to John chapter 19 and verse 30. John 19 and verse 30. And this is what we find in that 19th chapter, verse 30. It says, "When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, 'It is finished.' And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost." Amen. This morning, I want to talk with you from the subject, the sermon from the cross, "It is finished." Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, God of our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we come before you today, O God, as a trembling people, a people who have seen difficult and horrific things, the incredible loss of life throughout our nation. We can only imagine the grief and bereavement that is being experienced by those in New York City and New Jersey and Detroit and Chicago and California. I pray, O God, that you will hold these people in the hollow of your hand, comfort them, encourage them in their time of loss. And Lord, we as a nation, as we in many instances tremble in the shadows of social distancing, pray that you will give us courage of heart, strength to realize that you sit on the throne. You're too loving to be unkind. You're too just to do anything wrong, and you're too wise to make a mistake. We are in your hands, and we know that weeping endureth only for a night. Joy will come in the morning. Bless now our time together. Open our eyes that we can see, our ears that we can hear, and our hearts that we might be able to receive what you have to say to us today. Amen. The resurrection from the cross, it is finished. Beloved, on this Resurrection Sunday morning, as I've said, I return to the seven last words or statements of Jesus from the cross. Now, a brief review of these statements is as follows. The first statement he made said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The second statement which he made toward the thief was, "Today you will be with me in paradise." The third statement made was to his mother and to the Apostle John, where he said, "Woman, behold your son," and to John, "Behold your mother." In the fourth statement, he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? The fifth word or statement simply said, I thirst. Sour wine mixed with gall and myrrh, which behaved as a narcotic to relieve the suffering of the victim, was given to him. But Matthew tells us that he tasted the substance but refused to drink it. He wanted to die right. He wanted to die with a clear head. Today, we come to the sixth word or statement from the cross, which says, it is finished. In our text, Jesus has reached the finish line of his ministry career and his earthly life. It has been an incredible journey. It began in Bethlehem in the meager confines of a manger. It progressed along the dusty roads of Palestine, created chaos among the religious hypocrites, sparkled with splendor as he healed the sick and raised the dead. Now he has come to the end of the road. With all of the incredible things that had taken place along the way, what was the meaning of the sixth statement? It is finished. Was he saying that he was finished with Israel after they had stubbornly rejected his loving invitation? Was he finished with the human race? Was he suggesting that his ministry had failed? I mean, how could a ministry that began with so much promise and potential end so badly? What did he mean when he said, it is finished? Let me say that Jesus' utterance, it is finished, in no way represented failure. It did not represent failure. Rather, it represented completion. And so by representing completion, it represents victory. Now, I want to suggest to you three things that Jesus meant when he said this. You will see it is finished meant that his physical suffering was finished. Secondly, it meant that his mission on earth was finished. And thirdly, it meant that his plan for redemption was finished. Look with me first at the first reason. His physical suffering was finished. Now, Jesus had been hanging on the cross for 6 hours in the heat of the Middle Eastern sun. Exposure, dehydration, infection from the gaping wounds, shock, and a whole host of other injuries had taken their toll on his body. Barely conscious, he utters ever so faintly, it is finished. In other words, my physical sacrifice is complete. Now, one might ask, was this gruesome, grotesque act of torture and violence necessary? If so, why? Yes, it was necessary because God the Father required it. He has always required a physical sacrifice for sin. Hebrews 9:22 says, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission of sin. In Old Testament times, the Father utilized the blood of bulls and goats and other animals, but they were temporary and therefore insufficient. Hebrews 10:4 says, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. No more year after year sacrifice of these crude and insufficient animals, God was saying. The Father required and demanded a once and for all supreme sacrifice. That once and for all supreme sacrifice was found in the body and the person of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 10:10 says, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Once for all. No repetition is needed. During the Lord's brief and tumultuous life on earth, he suffered physically, didn't he? The Gadarenes ran him out of town. The Pharisees took up rocks to stone him. The religious leaders worked feverishly to undermine his reputation. His enemies crucified him. Like David, he lived under threat to life and limb. Now, all of his physical suffering was complete. It was finished. Not only was his physical suffering finished, but his mission on earth was finished. Jesus did not come to earth for nothing. He didn't come to hang out or to chill with his Jewish homies. He came to earth for a reason. He had a job to do. He had a purpose. He had a mission to accomplish. And this mission had a twofold purpose. We see that twofold purpose in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20 and verse 28. It says, "Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many." Now, this text reveals Jesus' twofold mission. One part of his mission is to minister or to serve. The other part of his mission was to die. See, Jesus did not come to attain political power, nor to gain financial wealth, nor to achieve impressive social notoriety. No, he came to serve and to die. Now, his service is demonstrated in what he taught. His service is demonstrated in how he healed the sick and raised the dead. His service is demonstrated how he cared for people. You can't serve folk if you don't care for folk. His service to man did not permit him to hang out with the bold and the beautiful, but the humble and the comely. His service would not permit him to get rich from earthly wealth, for the foxes have their holes and the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man have no place to lay his head. His service would not allow him to ascend to an earthly throne, but to prepare for an eternal one. Jesus was not arrogant, but humble, secure, not insecure, selfless, not selfish. He gave instead of taking. He came to serve. Another part of his mission was to die. To die. Listen, no matter how tragic, how horrible, and how terrible, and how unfair his death on the cross was, it was not a mistake. During the Ancient of Days, preparation was made from the headquarters of heaven for him to come and die. However, to those who saw him die, and those who perpetrated his death, they believed that his death was nothing more than a failed enterprise. To them, Jesus was nothing more than a misguided wannabe Messiah. They believed that this Son of God, King of Israel business, had gotten out of hand. It had gone to his head. Perhaps he had read too many of his own press clippings. To them, Jesus' delusions of grandeur had gotten him killed. They never considered that it was his mission all along to die. But I stop by to tell you that Jesus was not delusional. He was not misguided. He hadn't made a mistake. He is the Messiah. He is the King of Israel. He is the Son of God. He came to give his life as a ransom for many. Therefore, his death on the cross did not signal defeat, but declared victory. Therefore, with his mission being complete, he was able to say, "It is finished." Well, his physical suffering was finished. His mission on earth was finished. Finally, the Lord's plan for redemption was finished. One of the great tragedies of the coronavirus pandemic is the federal government's lack of a plan to defeat the virus. Because it has no plan, many more people are dying who didn't have to. You see, there can be no victory without a plan for victory. When the human race became infected with the disease of sin. God realized that there needed to be a plan in place for man's redemption. There was only one plan that would suffice. There was only one plan that would be sufficient. And that plan was the cross. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 14 says, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances or indebtedness that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. The text is telling us that mankind was indebted to God for his sin. And all indebtedness requires redemption. In other words, the debt had to be paid in full. And unless that indebtedness was paid, then man would die in his sin. For every sin required satisfaction to God. Well, thanks be unto God, because of the cross, all of our sins have been paid for. All of our sin was nailed to the cross. All of our lies were nailed to the cross. All of our hatred was nailed to the cross. All of our corrupt intentions were nailed to the cross. All of our inhumanity was nailed to the cross. All of our foolish mistakes were nailed to the cross. All of our regrets were nailed to the cross. All of our shame was nailed to the cross. No wonder the songwriter wrote, alas, and did my Savior bleed? And did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all of the day. At the cross, they nailed his hands and they nailed his feet. And when that final nail struck his flesh, Jesus was able to say that the plan of redemption is finished. Yes, when Jesus said it is finished, he was simply telling us that his physical sacrifice was finished. His mission on earth was finished. And his plan for redemption was finished. The declaration of being finished did not concede defeat, but declared victory. They took him down from the cross and buried him, amen, in a borrowed tomb. But that's not how the story would end, because 3 days later, he rose again. Didn't he do it? But before he got up, Jesus made a visit to the office of hell and told the devil a few things. He said, devil, your game is over. Your hope for victory is dashed. Your maniacal plan to destroy mankind has failed. Satan, you are a liar and the father of lies. And I declare to you today that you are finished. Beloved, when the road we travel has been long and hard, we're glad to see it end, aren't we? Just as the marathon runner longs for the finish line and the football player longs for the goal line, we as a community, a nation, a world, while living under the heavy burden of social distancing, financial uncertainty, and the fear of death, long for the finish line to this pandemic, don't we? We have lost precious friends and loved ones in the great cities of New York, New Jersey, New Orleans, Detroit, Chicago, and other places. Therefore, we want more than anything to be able to say to the tragedy and threat of COVID-19 and to the devil who brought it, we are done with you in the name of Jesus, in the name of our resurrected Savior, in the name of our conquering King, in the name of our bridge over troubled water, in the name of our shelter in the time of storm. In Jesus' name, it is finished. It is finished. In this life, we will have tragedy. In this life, we will have trouble. And we get tired sometimes. We grow weary. We're tired now. But just understand that what we're going through will not always be. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. And that light is being brought forth by faith in the Lord. Trust in Him. You know, I've heard a lot of explanations as to why this pandemic has come our way. Some people try to blame certain groups. Some people try to blame those who are gay. Some people try to blame those who are corrupt in other ways. We start picking and choosing sin and try to place the blame on a certain group. But you can't place this thing on one particular group because all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Then why, brother preacher, why the pandemic? The pandemic has come for the express purpose that we live in a fallen world. And when you live in a fallen world, then you're going to have tragedy. You're going to have a catastrophe. You're going to have trouble because this fallen world, the trouble that we see are the consequences of man's sin. The only answer for every man, white, black, gay, straight, rich, poor, is Jesus Christ. Stop placing blame. Stop trying to blame other folk for what has happened because we are all culpable. Stop it and realize that one day God will say all of our troubles, all of our sorrows, all of our heartaches, all of our catastrophes, all of our pandemics, He will one day say, it is finished. Father God, we thank You for Your word. We thank You, O God, for Your peace. We thank You, Lord, for Your care. I realize, Lord, that we are living in a horribly difficult time. 2,000 lives lost in one day. People dying alone. Bodies being buried without even being embalmed. Makeshift graves are being dug on islands to place all the bodies. Never thought that we would see such a day, but that day has come. Now we turn to a God who's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above anything that we could ever imagine or think. Help us, Lord, through this difficult time. I don't know about tomorrow, but I know who holds tomorrow in His hand. And if You keep us, we'll be kept. And we'll make it out on the other side. And we'll realize the scripture is true. Weeping endureth only for night. Joy will come in the morning. If there's someone who has not received Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord, I pray, Holy Spirit, that You will touch their hearts today. And they will say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Save me today. I need You to help me to make this journey. And one day I want to hear You say about all my sorrows and my troubles, it is finished. It's in Christ's name and for His sake we pray. Amen. Again, I want to thank you today for sharing with us. I want to say that immediately following this message that there will be a special Easter Sunday reflection program. It is a special Easter service that was recorded here at our church a number of years ago. I hope it will be a blessing to you. I believe that it will. And so I want you to just hang around for a little bit and see the Easter service. Also, I want you to know also that we are in need of your support financially. Over the past several weeks, we have been asking you to support this ministry and no doubt other ministries in a variety of ways through PayPal, which is available to anyone who would like to try to do that. Also, you are able to drop off your offering here by the church. If you'd like somebody to come and pick it up, you can call the church at area code 423-629-6248 or 423-595-2697. Or you can feel free to mail your gift to 810 Shalford Road, Chattanooga, Tennessee, 37411. Whatever you can do to help our church and to other ministries like ours during this COVID pandemic will be greatly appreciated. Again, in closing, beloved, as I said, how long the road of this pandemic, we do not know. But I'm comforted by the words of the 90th Psalm that says, Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. And we will never doubt that you are God over all things. Be with us now as we go and continue this journey of faith. Amen. God bless you, and may God keep you.
Good evening, I'm Katrina Brown, and I work with the Puggles Group. This evening, I will be introducing the speeches for the Puggy and Cubby Clubbers. And our first one is Kedrick Green of the Puggles, and his speech is Welcome One and All.
Love you, B. Did you stand here, John? If you wish, welcome one.
Our next puggle is Alyssa Walton with Easter Wish.
A happy Easter. What I want to say, that I want to listen, that I want to stay.
Okay, our next our first cubby is Reuben Justice with Not Too Small.
No, I may be little, there's things I can't do, but I can shout loud and clear. Happy Easter to you.
Okay, our next cubby is Elena Harrison with Easter is here.
Hey,
a conclusion by telling, thank you, Spirit of time. So glad to change, to hear Jesus rather, to become a glorious king.
Okay, our next cubby is Joshua Brown with Easter Joy. Okay, our next cubby is Makaria Hudson with Easter Light.
Easter light,
shining clear,
shining clear.
Easter blessing,
Easter blessing.
Now draw near, now.
Now
draw near,
draw near.
Easter joy is everywhere. Easter joy,
Easter joy
is everywhere.
Everywhere.
My name is Alicia Moore, and I work with the Sparks. Gloria Dozier, Tracy Perriman, and Dee Davis also work with the Sparks. Our first person is Ariel Brown. Easter is here.
Easter's here. Easter's here, we're full of cheer. We're so glad you came to hear our stories and songs and praise our dear Lord's name.
All right.
Rogeria Bell.
Every flower Easter seems to say to me, Jesus gave his beauty for all of us to see.
Elena Collins, welcome.
Welcome, we are so glad to see you. I'm sure you'll never guess how much you've been with us as to our happiness. Of course you know that Easter Christ rose from the tomb and that he lived forever to banish sin and gloom.
If you will,
make him welcome right in your heart, he'll stay, and you will learn why Christians are joyful every day.
Amen. Lee Brown? He's not here. Vanell Moore? All things are new. All things.
things
are new.
Are you?
And hopes are bright.
And hopes are bright.
The sun breaks through.
The sun breaks through.
With morning light.
Good morning light.
All things are new.
All things are new.
This Easter morn.
This Easter morning.
For it is true.
For it is true.
I've been reborn.
I've been reborn.
Tyra Moore, not there.
The tomb is empty. Jesus is not there. His love with us to share.
He has risen.
He has risen from the dead.
Thomas Howell, stand tall.
Stand very tall for Easter Day. And Jesus loves everybody. And,
Jesus is my Savior.
Jesus is my Savior.
That's all I have to say.
All I have to say. Got six more words to say. Jesus, I love Jesus every day.
Adam Cottle, we love to talk about Jesus.
We love to talk about Jesus and sing about him too. He rose on Easter morning to say you and you and you and me. Yeah.
Shardasia Carter, the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us.
The Bible tells us.
Jesus is our brother.
Jesus is our brother.
He came to show us.
He came to show us.
How to love each other.
How to love each other.
The Bible tells us.
The Bible tells us.
Jesus rose on Easter Day.
Jesus rose from Easter Day.
He came to save us.
He came to save us.
And be with us every day.
And be with us every day.
Audrey Harrison, we thank.
We think of Jesus by Eldred Russell. He left the. We think of Jesus by Eldred Russell in the tomb. He left the cross to conquer death and to take our sins away.
Vinaya Carter, new and bright.
We can see the Savior
in resurrection power.
Resurrection power.
If we
in faith
accept him this very day and hour.
Very hour.
He will make each morning Easter new and bright.
Easter new and bright.
His glory fills.
His glory fill
all loving hearts.
Glory heart.
And makes them glad and light.
Let their glad and light.
Good afternoon. My name is Artina Bates, and I am Director of Truth and Training, grades 3-5. First, we have Asia Davenport, my Easter message.
I can't sing a solo, I can't play a flute, I can't play the organ, but my daddy thinks I'm cute.
Daddy says that Jesus loves me, and I know what Jesus, Daddy says is true. Now that's my Easter message for you, you, and you.
Okay, next I have Jeffrey Thomas on this Easter day. I have William Carter, Rejoice. Okay, I have he has it with him.
Rejoice, my friends, the day is here. I think the finest day, I think the finest other year. New life is promised every spring. New life is what our faith will bring. No sorrow then, faith instead, joy instead. For Jesus came forth from the dead. Rejoice.
Okay, next I have Delicia Davis. We wish you happy Easter.
Birds are singing gladly now from the green of a leaf brought. Baby lambs and kittens play, and it all seems to me they say, we wish you a happy Easter.
Okay, I have Mercedes Geiger, Christ Indeed is Savior. Okay. Next, I have Desmond Ratliff, Son of God. Okay, we'll come back to Desmond. I have Thomas Patton the Third, Thomas. Okay, Deshaun Beach, the soldier. Andrell Martin, Spring Awakening. Okay, and I have Ladarius Ramsey.
Robins are singing, happy and clear, flowers are blooming, Easter is here. The church bells are ringing, hear how they say, Jesus is risen and liveth today.
Okay, and I have Desmond Ratliff, Son of God.
They took you to the garden, you answered not a word. When Peter tried to save you, you said, put down your sword. They mocked you in the trial and shouted in the den. Pilate gave his judgment, I find no fault in him. They killed you on Golgotha. They hung you on a tree. One believing Roman soldier said, the Son of God is he.
Thank you.
Let's give our children a hand.
Now that we do, he rose. Oh, you have one more. One more, I'm sorry. They have one more.
All right, I have one more. Kendall Cottle.
Easter acrostic. E is the first letter for everlasting life. A is the second. He abides in my life. S is the next one. My Savior, he is. T likes Thanksgiving, though Easter it is. E's nearly over, not far from the end. Remember, Christ said he would be coming again. R is the last letter of what Easter's about. Resurrection as promised, our ultimate clout. So death has been beaten out of our lives, no longer our ruler. New life in his life, together spells Easter.
Okay, and we have Unique Carter.
His hands was nailed to the cross. Arms, his feet was nailed to the base. He left no arms, but he left no hands.
Only our hands.
No feet, but our feet in his place.
He died
with arms reaching outward, okay, and treating all from take parts. But we by
thoughtless demeanor,
driving nails through his heart.
Good job.